Mednick. Doing another session of our hangar talk. It's just an unscripted little bit of ground school that we're doing here in Zephyr Hills. And if you missed our first session on aerodynamics, I strongly recommend that you view that video first because it'll help you to understand some of the concepts we're going to be talking about today. So first off, I've done my best. I know this is a little sloppy and it is not to scale. But what it does is it's going to highlight some of the different steps that are involved in the technique that we teach. Now, like anything, a landing, there's many different ways to do a landing. This is a steep approach, power off, soft field landing. And so where this landing is going to have some shortcomings is this is not the best landing to do for a spot landing, which would also be your short field landing. Okay, so there's other techniques we won't talk about today. But you know, if you're doing short landings and spot landings, you're probably a more experienced pilot, so you're not gonna need to know that right away. So that brings us back to the primary staple of, okay, let's assume we have plenty of runway, and let's assume that we want to practice a technique that's going to allow us to land very consistently, very safely. It's going to allow us to transition into midday bumps and higher wind. So it starts blowing 15, 20 miles an hour. We have a technique that's going to work and well beyond those wind speeds as well. If your engine should quit or you have loss of power and you have to dead stick in, this is the technique to use, in my opinion. And especially if you're going to be landing in an unimproved field, you don't know what you're going to be touching down in, and there might be a foxhole or who knows. This technique is for that. So this is pretty much my go-to landing technique. Very transferable. So in other words, when we teach this technique to our students, after they've gotten a little bit of practice with it, they can execute it very, very close to or as good as the instructors can. So it's a very transferable skill. There is an actual method to this madness here. So first thing I want to talk about is we've got five basic steps to this technique. The first step is we want to be lined up with the runway, preferably as soon as possible, whatever it takes. The longer your final is, the more time you're going to have to get lined up. But what we don't want to do is be offset from the runway and then just working our way over while we're on our way down landing to make it over to get centered. So the first thing we want to do is we want to be lined up with the runway to start. And that's up here. We're lined up, we want to be power off, and we want to be in a best glide somewhere around there. So that's going to be a neutral control bar, and the aircraft just gliding along the runway. So a lot of times my students are always asking, Larry, what altitude do I need to be at when I turn final? Well, that really depends. It all depends. If you turn final real short, you might need to be at 300 feet. If you turn a mile final, you might need to be at 1,000 feet, at pattern altitude. So again, we need to look at the angle. So that's all I can really say is we're going to be talking a lot about angles today. And the angle down to the runway and understanding your aircraft's performance. You know, if you're in something very draggy, you're going to need a very steep angle. If you're in something that really, really glides, you're going to need less of an angle to make it to your landing zone. So when you're gliding down to your landing spot, one of the things you do want to consider is that we are going to have a steep approach somewhere at the end of this glide. So you can't just line up to where you think you want to go. You need to line up a little bit beyond that to take an account for this steep approach that we're going to do. Now, when we get down to somewhere between 200 and 300 AGL, so above ground level, it's different for different trikes. If you have a really slow trike, something with a very limited speed range, like a Rev or a float trike with like a 20-meter wing on it, you're going to want to start your dive probably a little bit lower to the ground. But this is kind of experimentation and knowing what your aircraft likes. And what the difference is on an aircraft that's a little bit heavier, has a wider speed range, it's going to take more time, more altitude to energize the wing. And that's what we're going to be doing here is we're going to be energizing the wing. Now, this here is kind of optional. if you have certain aircraft, usually really high performance aircraft, blade wings, it just really depends on the model, you may be able to skip this step altogether. This is only to help the aircraft get into a steep approach. So it can be useful, but if there's one thing that could be optional here, it's the slowdown process. So the reason that we would slow a trike down in order to put the nose down into the steep approach is because trikes don't like to put their noses down. They have very limited ability to pitch forward. So if you're trying to get the nose to come forward when you pull the control bar back and it kind of fights you and you wind up with the bar almost back to your ribs just to get the nose down, the odds of you being able to continue down a steep approach for 200-300 feet are slim to none at that point. So if you slow the aircraft down by, you're in a best glide, your control bar is in a neutral position here, and I should just turn this way, and we're just gliding along. We want to slow the plane down. I'm going to move the control bar 6 inches forward, and I'm going to wait. I'm not going to push the bar out slow to slow it down. I'm going to move the control bar forward 6 inches, and I'm going to wait, and what's going to happen is the nose of the trike should pitch up. I'm going to wait for the aircraft to now slow, and at that point, I've achieved this part here that's in yellow. And it's very important that if you don't have a stabilized glide approach where your neutral bar before you start to slow the aircraft down, let's say you're coming in and you hit a thermal and the nose comes up, and now you decide you're going to push the bar out 6 inches. The nose may rotate forward while you've done this. So it's very important that you're stabilized, that your nose is down in a best glide. When you slow the aircraft down, it's going to nose up. And so you're looking for that pitch change in the carriage to know that that's been executed properly. A big mistake that gets made is instead of letting the control bar out 6 inches, they continue to push, and now we're almost at a stall. We don't need to go that far. We don't need to, it's not useful, and it'll tend to cause the next step, which is our nose over, to possibly become too radical. And we're not looking for anything radical. In fact, nothing in this, although this is all out of proportion, so it may look like a roller coaster here, it's not this aggressive, but I really wanted to differentiate the different angles to you so that it would be easier to see. When you drop the nose, the control bar now, which is 6 inches out from neutral, you're gonna move the controls back quickly, about like this. The nose is gonna drop, and then you're gonna put the controls back to neutral. A lot of people say, well, isn't the nose gonna come back up if I return the control bar back to neutral, and what's the whole point? Why don't I just pull the bar back and hold it back? Again, this system is to try and make this as easy as possible. So all of this is just to get the nose down and be able to keep the nose down on a steep approach. By putting the nose down from a slow speed, leans over, and returning the bar, we are now at this stage, the aircraft is aiming at the ground quite steeply. It's probably half of what your glide ratio is normally, as a like a rule of thumb. So whatever this is twice as bad of a glide ratio. That's a good aggressive glide ratio. And the way you'll know that you're doing this glide correctly, the angle is correct, is if you're too steep, the point that you initially started aiming at the ground, you're not able to hold that. The aircraft is pulling out of the dive. It's a non-sustainable steep dive. And if that happens, that's not good. At the same time, you put the nose down and you're able to keep the nose down, but you're not steep enough. When you get down to our next point, which is our roundout point, you may notice that you're having to push the bar out a lot to make the roundout, or that when you cross over the transition gradient, which we're going to touch on in a second, the aircraft starts to fall. So at about 75 feet, we have this transition gradient. We want to be fully energized by the time that before we cross the transition gradient, we want all of our airspeed that we're going to build up for this steep approach, which is a high energy approach. It can be used in gusty conditions and crosswinds and everything else, But we want to achieve all that airspeed before we cross the transition gradient. So if you feel the aircraft start to drop quickly at around 75 feet off the ground, you probably were not steep enough. So those are the ways to know if you're too steep or too shallow in your steep approach. The other good telltale sign is that you want some back pressure on your fingers. You want to feel that bar pulling forward. That's another very good sign. Hey, I've got energy, okay? What a lot of people confuse is that I've got the control bar back to my rib cage, I'm extra fast. And that may not be true at all. So here's what you have to know about that. First of all, we're gliding at 60 miles per hour, let's just say. This 60 should not change. It is a stabilized power off glide. And these figures are going to be similar to if you're training in a Revo, for example. That's probably about what it glides at. Right here, when we let that bar out 6 inches, we're still going 60. It's going to really kind of count down. It's 59, 58, 50. And we want to get it down to about 50. So we're going to lose 10 miles an hour when we let the control bar out, the nose comes up, and we're waiting. When the nose comes up and we're going this direction, we need to probably count 1-1,000, 2-1,000, 3-1,000. At least 2 or 3 seconds. Allow the aircraft to slow down once it noses up. So many times the student will do a beautiful slow down, the nose noses up, and then they're putting in the dive right away. They're not waiting that 1-1,000, 2-1,000, 3-1,000, and then drop the nose. The slower you get, the easier it's going to be to drop the nose. If you don't slow down very much at all, it's going to be harder to drop the nose. When you drop your nose, again, we're looking for something sustainable that you can keep going all the way down until it's time to break it off, which is our round out that we're going to get to next. If you overdive, and this technique here is going to make it possible to overdive. Normally, if you're just coming in and you decide you're going to just go ahead and pull the bar back to start your dive, you can't overdive. You can't hardly get the nose down as steep as you may even want it. But when you implement this, you're going to be able to drop the nose considerably. And so what can happen is you drop the nose too steep, and again, I'm exaggerating here just to, so you can see what we're talking about. The aircraft will accelerate too quickly. Again, the bar is back to your chest at this point. And now the aircraft will start to pitch out of the steep approach. You haven't moved the bar. This is onset from speed. Now the aircraft's actually getting very slow. In fact, I'd say we might even be getting back down to around 60. Bar still hasn't moved, still pinned to your chest. And now it starts in on this drop and we're going maybe 65. And we're aiming at the ground. Everything's gonna happen very, very quickly. We have high descent rate, we have low energy, and the bar is back. So having the control bar back on this approach, going, I did it, I had the bar back, I had good energy, is completely untrue and false. What's important is that the angle that you've picked sustains. And the lowest angle, so let's just use some numbers here. Let's say that what we're looking for is a 30 degree nose down. This one here, we go 45 degrees nose down, but then it pitches out and we wind up at 20 degrees nose down. You need to compare the lowest angle in your dive. That's the number that counts. If you want to know how good and how much energy you carried in your steep approach, you're going to use the lowest angle of the dive as how you grade the energy that you had in that dive. So if you get down to 20 degrees here and you stayed at 30 here, this is a much higher energy dive and a better dive for where we need to use this dive. We use this dive starting down here. And so the real question is, how much energy do we have when we get ready for our roundouts? Now, because we're accelerating, so we're back up to here, I'm going to talk about the actual correct method. which is to follow a line that is sustainable, a sustainable dive. Okay. So again, 60, 60, 60, we let the bar out, we slow to 50, we put the nose down, and we return the bar. At the moment that we have put the nose down and returned the bar, what do you suppose our airspeed is right here? We're talking a half a second. I put the nose down, I put the bar back. What do you think our airspeed is?
50.
Around 50, absolutely. We have not gained any magical airspeed by pulling the control bar in. It takes time for the aircraft to accelerate. So just because we were going this way and now we're going this way, there just isn't any drop. It's like if you're on a bicycle and all of a sudden you go over a hill, yeah, you're gonna accelerate, but you haven't accelerated. We'll call it 51. We're talking marginal speed increase, and that's why if the control bar being out here was good when we're going this way, slowing it down, when we put the nose over to dive, it's good enough to put the control bar back where it was. Now, what do you suppose the advantage of having the control bar out with the nose down at the beginning of your dive is versus having the control bar in at the beginning of your dive?
Because as you start picking up speed, the nose is going to want to come up, so that gives you the ability to bring the nose back down.
That's right.
Now, if you keep it at your chest, you got nowhere to go.
That's exactly the correct answer. And so now what's going to happen is this 50 miles an hour is going to accelerate very quickly to 55. That's going to happen in the next second or two. And it's going to continue to increase to 60. And it's going to increase to 65. And it's going to go to 70, 75, might even hit 80. 80 is a nice high energy. Talking about a revo here, and again, just arbitrary numbers. But we got a 60 mile an hour cruise. We want to throw 20 mile an hour on top of our best glide speed in this example. So whatever percentage that is, if you're flying a slower aircraft that goes 40, you might be accelerating to 52. So it's all very proportionate. But one thing I will tell you is whether you're flying a revo, a rev, a flying boat, the angle method is going to work. So you can take that airspeed indicator and chuck it out the aircraft, because it is about useless in helping you to do this technique. In fact, if you're watching your airspeed indicator, because your airspeed indicator lags, you're going to get false information every time, every second you're looking at, oh, I'm going 50. Oh, now I'm going 55. And by the time you're registering it and it's registering it, you're so far behind what's happening. It's all about angle. And so the angle is going to give you the energy. Don't look at the airspeed indicator. You know, sometimes my students will kind of do a quick check and they'll check their altimeter. If they like 300 feet AGL for their application, they'll look down at their altimeter and see. But use it as a check. Don't rely on your altimeter to know when to dive. You get a cold front come in or something and throw your altimeter off 100 feet in the blink of an eye. You do not want to start this maneuver 100 feet lower because your altimeter said so. So get that sight picture of knowing when it's time to start that dive. You can do a quick check for consistency at your altimeter as you put the nose down, but don't use the altimeter to know when to put the nose down. As we're picking up speed, the control bar must have the controls being moved back. Okay? The aircraft can only fly at a particular speed, at a particular weight, at a particular angle of attack. So if you leave the bar in one spot and leave the angle of attack in one spot, one of two things is going to happen. One, the aircraft's not accelerating, you're in stabilized flight, which is not the case, as we know that this angle was 60, now we're at 50 and we're at this angle. So we're going to be doing some accelerating here. And if we fail to move the control bar back as the airspeed increases, as a result of the steep approach because gravity is pulling us down, the nose of the trike is simply going to start to pitch up. Now, if you get down to the bottom and you were able to hold and you got up to your 80 mile an hour goal that we're looking for, again, we're not watching an airspeed indicator, and the bar's pinned to your ribs, that's not correct. It's not somewhere, something is messed up before then. So we're not looking to pull bar back to the ribs, but a lot of times you wind up with the control bar pulled back to your ribs and the plane's fighting you, it doesn't want to dive. What happened? Well, what happened was you're doing real good. Let me get my red marker again. the nose was coming down. Usually you can hold it. The first third, if we talk about this in 1, 2, 3, we've got 3 sections. We've got our first section. That's really easy. Very easy to overdive the first section of the dive. Very, very easy to overdive. We already talked about what will happen from an overdive, overspeed. It'll pull out, all kinds of bad stuff's gonna happen. Very easy to hold your speed if you're not doing a good job with your control bar, but usually you don't even hardly have to move your control bar at all. The second half is where people lose it. Second half, they tend not to move the control bar fast enough, and the trike starts to pull out of this nice steep dive that they had going. As it pulls out of the dive, the pilot realizes, oh shoot, I'm losing it. And they pull the bar back and they pick up that nice line, the correct direction. They pick it back up. But right here, to get that nose back down, once you allow the nose to come up, to get it back where it was, is gonna take a tremendous amount of pulling the control bar back. So the guy that just stays ahead of it and keeps the nose at one attitude, no problem. The guy that has a brain fart, lets the nose come up and then gets back on it, he's working back here, the other guy is still working in here. So letting that nose depart, and that'll usually happen in the second section of the steep approach. The nose will pitch out, the pilot gets on it, but now we're all back here. And of course your motor skills are not very good to control your roll. You've got a tremendous amount of back pressure on the controls. And ultimately, you're doing the same thing, but instead of having a nice easy ride down with the controls here, you've got the bar pinned and you are fighting this thing. And one gust of wind, one thermal, the nose will pitch up and you can't get the nose back down. You lose the dive and then all kinds of bad stuff happens here. In fact, the steeper you are here, within reason, the steeper you are here at the end of the dive, and you've kept it consistent, the more airspeed you have. The more airspeed you have here, the longer all of the rest of this part, which is of course the part that really everybody has to work on the most, right, is the round out and the flare, and of course the touchdown happens after that. The faster you are here, the longer you're gonna have to do the other things. So is longer easier? Almost always. If you have more time, it's kind of like everything's happening in slow motion, and that's what we want. So if you're getting down to the roundout and everything's happening in fast motion, whoa, 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 and we're on the ground. That's not what this should look like. From this point, again in a Revo, we're somewhere in the neighborhood of 10 to 20 seconds from point of touchdown. That's a long time, 20 seconds to get it together. An incorrect approach can leave you at this point 4 or 5 seconds from point of touchdown. We got no energy, we got no time to do anything at the bottom. Everything's gonna happen real quick, and we pray that you do it right the first time, because there's no time to fix anything when you don't have your speed. So this part right here, if this isn't right, this isn't gonna be right. In fact, you can backtrack that to any point. All good landings are preceded by a good approach. But you've gotta have every step of the way correct to get that good touchdown. An expert pilot, yeah, he can take something bad and turn it into good. But when you're just learning and you're wanting to get this technique consistent, you can't miss a step. You can't come down and, oh man, I'm 150 feet. Let me just start my dive at 150 feet. The approach has been blown. You can't miss a step and expect a good result to follow after that. But this one right here, if you can get your speed and keep your nose down at the point of round out, now you've got a chance to have a nice 10, 15 second time to do all this stuff down here near the runway. And time is good. Time lets everything be slow. So getting back to that transition gradient real quick, it's covered more on our last hangar talk regarding aerodynamics. But basically, if the wind is less on the ground and higher, winds aloft, which is almost always, unless you're talking dead still air, you can expect a change in airspeed here and here. Two things: the more energy you have in your wing, the better. the more you're aiming at the ground, the less you're going to be facing the problem. So if you were to dive vertically through the transition gradient, it would literally have almost no effect on your airspeed. If you were to power down, you're coming in power on, and you're very, I mean, we're talking a 3-degree glide slope, power on. As you cross this transition gradient, almost parallel to the transition gradient, you're gonna have the most amount of effect, negative effect, that you can possibly get from that transition gradient. So nose down, high energy, and the last thing is we're falling. We're coming down, we're falling through that transition gradient. When you're doing this technique correct, unless you've got maybe a big tree line or something like that, you should not have to add any power as you go through the transition gradient. Some really slow trikes, nanolites, they may feel it more. And of course, if you start to fall and you feel additional sink, always go to the throttle, whether you're fixing and you're reducing sink rate or you've decided to go around. But you don't push the control bar out to arrest sink rate and start your round out high at 75 feet off the ground. We see that a lot. The plane starts to drop because they haven't done any of this very well. They hit the transition gradient and they say, oh man, let's go this way. And all of a sudden, they're not getting down low enough to start the round out. They've all of a sudden started going this way. Speed slows down to about 60. And at that point, why do we even bother with any of this? Because we're right back to where we started, which was 60 mile an hour. So very, very unuseful to break out of the steep approach prematurely. And that happens a lot.
So you recommend going around at that point. Hit the gas while you still have some altitude. And
as soon as you've recognized, as soon as you've recognized that something's askew, abort the landing. You know, perfect practice makes perfect. Practicing bad can be not only not useful, it can be detrimental. You want to practice perfect. So practice perfect, and also it can be very dangerous too, and we're talking about landing an aircraft here. So when things are not going according to plan, don't think that things will just get better. You should hear people that have had an accident on the runway, and you hear their recount, if they can remember what happened. Well, yeah, and then this happened, I probably should have gone around, and then this happened, I probably should have gone around, and I figure I could just get it here. And it's like, you're listening to this going, you're kidding me, right? But this is what happened. And so it's usually not everything was going great, I mean, everything was just perfect, and then all of a sudden, something happened. That is so rare, so rare. So yeah, get out of there, go around. All right, so that is how we get into our round out, and that is very, very important to understand. And we're gonna go to the eraser now, and we're gonna talk a lot more about the round out. The round out, in my opinion, is the most misunderstood maneuver out of the whole landing. So when we're flaring the aircraft, I'm skipping ahead of the round out now, when we're flaring the aircraft, people seem to kind of understand that concept. But the round out, it really gets confused. It gets confused between its own entity and what it is and the flare, because they are as dissimilar as possible. In a flare, we're starting off a flare. By the way, a flare is about 6 to 12 inches off the ground. If you're at 3 feet, you're not flaring, you're flying high. If you start climbing, that's called a balloon. Very, very common. I'm gonna tell you exactly why trikes balloon. There's a few different reasons, but that's a balloon. But when you're in the flare, you're flying parallel to the ground, and your airspeed, going back to our airspeed we were talking about, hopefully we've carried 75 mile an hour. We were at 80 as we started the round out. We're gonna lose a little bit in the round outs, but we're gonna try not to lose anything in the round outs. And I'll explain the round out in a second. But now, we're going 75 mile an hour. We're gonna slow down to 70. We're gonna slow down to 65. We're gonna slow down to 60, 55, 50. And finally, at a certain point, the control bar is gonna be all the way out at the front strut. And the aircraft is just no longer going to fly anymore. The aircraft is going to land itself. You are not going to put the wheels on the ground. The aircraft, the pilot is trying to fly the aircraft this way, and the aircraft is going to go this way. And so there is no such thing as you landing the plane. The last thing that you did in the landing is you tried to fly the plane and failed. So you hear about people rushing a landing. Well, that's the pilot not attempting to fly the plane and the plane not flying. That's the pilot not flying the plane, letting the aircraft on the ground, which has all kinds of consequences, which we'll talk about a little bit later. But the point is, just like when we were accelerating on our steep approach, when we get into the flare, we're decelerating. And if we're decelerating, that means that the control bar is moving forward. If you move the control bar forward too quickly, the aircraft will balloon. If you move the control bar too slowly, the aircraft will not hold. And again, we're only 6 to 12 inches off the ground. It will possibly land. And if you touch down at 65, it will most likely ricochet off the ground. So I don't call it a landing. You can call it a bounce. You can call it a ricochet. But that's not holding your flare. So the flare, the control bar is moving forward, and we're changing airspeed. The dive, the control bar is moving back, we're changing airspeed. So back to the roundout. We've got our steep approach up here. We know how we got there. And now, let's see if I can do this. Pretty good. Now we're going to start our round out. All right, so if you remember what I said, you know, we're going to start to slow the aircraft down. The bar is in one position, and we move the control bar, and then we let the aircraft pitch up. Well, we're going to do exactly the opposite now on this side of the approach. We're going to release pressure on the control bar. So we've got a lot of pressure because we're in the steep approach. We're just going to release pressure. You may not even have to physically see yourself move the control bar. You're going to just release pressure. And what are we not going to see when you release pressure? And this is very confusing to most of the students. We were going this way on our steep approach. All of a sudden, you've done your deal. You've released some pressure. You're going to feel G-force in your seat. Not a lot, but you're going to feel something start to happen. But what you're not going to see is the aircraft go this direction. And we don't want to go that direction. We want to get down here to our flare. And our flare, let's just call it 12 inches. So our flare is 12 inches. We want to get down to 12 inches. So where do we start this? Well, it's going to be a little bit different, but I will say this. You want to do this so that you are not pulling a bunch of G's. Okay, on a Revo again, we want to start this around 20 feet in the air. On something that is a little bit slower, you may start it at half that height. But what you don't want to do is we don't want to come down and do an itty little bitty tiny round out into a flare. Now here's the problem with doing a tiny round out. And by the way, after you're practicing this a lot, what my students will tend to do is they're going to tend to do this number. So let me be more realistic. They just round out with too tight of a radius, and they wind up 10 feet in the air. And of course, once you're parallel the runway, is 10 feet below you, is there really any fixing this? Not without just starting a whole new landing that has nothing to do with the technique that we're practicing and training to do. So this is we gotta abort that. That's no good. So the next time they come around, they say, okay, well, I rounded out 20 feet, and I wound up stopping and going into, like, call it a flare, a 10-foot tall flare, which is not a flare. That's just flying down the runway 10 feet. I'm just going to go ahead and get way down low and do the same thing. Well, the problem is now your timing starts to become critical. If you're a second late, crash into the runway. That's bad. If you're a second early, you know, but there's a lot of timing, and now things are happening quick at the bottom of the landing. What's so great about this landing technique? Well, one of the things that's great about our landing technique is nothing's happening quick at the bottom. Everything's happening in slow motion at the bottom. So that's the first reason we don't want to round out at 5, 6, 8 feet. We don't want it to happen quick, and your timing's probably not good enough for it anyway. But let's just say you time it absolutely perfect. Within a tenth of a second, you round out. What's going to happen is you're going to have to pull high G's. Right? You're coming down at 80 miles an hour, and you want to stop an 80 mile an hour descent in 6 feet. You can pull some G's. You can pull 2 G's. Now, if you pull 1 G, you're going to crash into the ground over here. That's no good. So you pull 2 G's because you need to pull 2 G's or we're going to crash. We're going to put a hole in the runway. We need 2 G's here to continue this round out. We need 2 G's here to continue this round out. We need 2 G's here to continue this round out. And now we're in straight and level flight. How many G's do you think that we might need to go that way?
Six.
One.
Oh, one.
1 G. We need 1. So, if you've seen the instructors that are coming in grabbing your controls at the last second, it looks something like this. And we finish the flare. So when we flare that quick and pull that many G's, the next thing we do is we bring the controls in. Now, if you're an amateur or a newbie pilot and you pull the controls in, you can crash harder than you ever imagined. You hit the ground while the control bar's coming in and hit the ground. You take out your front forks, you take out your whole aircraft. So the golden rule, if you take anything away from this little jam session that we're doing here, is that you never, ever, ever sink towards the runway and pull the control bar in. That never happens. If you're coming down, you're pushing out. If you're going up, you're pulling in. But you're never pulling in and going down. Never, ever, 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 ever. And if you hit the ground while you're pulling in, it can be devastating on the aircraft. You can hit the ground excessively hard, however. If you push out and you didn't have enough energy, and you push out and hit the ground, the aircraft is probably not going to roll over. A lot of bad things are probably not going to happen. So getting that bar forward. So very dangerous to pull the control bar in. But I can tell you one thing. If you pull a 2G round out, because you started late and you had to pull 2Gs, and we're talking you got down to 12 inches. The height's right. Everything's good. The next thing that's going to happen is 2Gs is going to send you this direction. It's going to be a beautiful, perfect execution. 2Gs, 2Gs. And now you're only starting to lose airspeed as we're going this direction. So if you're not prepared to pull the control bar back in so you don't balloon after you pull high G's, and it doesn't have to be 2 G's, it could be 1.5 G's. But the more G's that you pull, the more you can expect to balloon. As soon as you come around towards 6 o'clock, towards that bottom, it's gonna wanna continue to climb. So, when we do a proper, and I gotta erase some of the stuff because I'm gonna forget which one's the right one here. When we do a proper round out, what we're really trying to do is we're really trying to hold the, and you can't, because we are arresting all of the descent, but the way to think about it is we are looking for 1G, or as close to it as possible. So when we start this round out up here, we're looking to feel a little bit more weight in our seat. Not a lot's happening, so we've released, we've let the bar out between probably 1 and 3 inches. If you're moving the control bar out 6 inches, 9 inches, one of two things is happening. One, you're letting the bar out way too much and the aircraft's not gonna follow this track. Or two, you have nowhere near enough airspeed to be doing this maneuver and you're not gonna have enough energy at the bottom because you're using all your energy just to do the round out. So it's more of a release of pressure than it is moving the control bar. So most people get the release of pressure part. Now, I mentioned earlier, this is where people get confused between a round out and a flare. In a flare, we're moving the control bar forward during the maneuver, we're slowing the aircraft down, we're changing angle of attack. We don't let the bar out. So you often hear the instructor, hold the bar in, just wait, just wait, just wait. And it is. you're going to need to just wait and let the aircraft do its thing. When you release that pressure on the controls, that is going to cause this to happen. This is a giant radius. It should not be lumpy. Now, if you notice that, man, nothing is happening, I really fear this is going to be bad. I feel like I'm going to hit the ground. I can see it coming. You need to be re-evaluating the round out like 3 or 4 times a second. You need to be just, you've let up pressure here, and now you need to evaluate where you see. Where is it going right now? Is it going here? Is it going here? Or is it going here? Which one is it? But you're re-evaluating, okay? If you think that you're here on this one, you're gonna let the bar out a little bit more, no problem. And we're gonna bring that right back in here, no problem. If you've let the bar out too much here, it's gonna go this direction. Now you need to pull the bar back in, or we're just gonna wind up 10 feet off the ground again. So you pull the control bar back in, we go this way, and hopefully we pick this back up again. So this is what we call a lump, a bump, or a hump in a round out. It's very, very detrimental to making it easy and everything happens slow at the bottom. Why? Because if you look, now we've got a tighter radius and everything's happening quicker again. Like if we would have just started the round out here instead of starting the round out here. So it's a lot better if you let the bar out just a little bit and then let the bar out a little bit more during the round out than letting the bar out too much and then pulling it back in again. That doesn't work as good. And so you just continue to watch. And again, at the bottom, you're still reevaluating. Maybe you think it's gonna go this way and this way, right? You're kind of seeing that I'm not getting down to the ground. You go ahead and you're gonna pull that control bar in again and pick up the line, the line. The line brings us down to 12 inches off the runway. Now here's what's amazing about using a radius. And let me compare that in contrast with somebody that, let me use a different color for this, lets the control bar out, and this is also very, very common. They let the control bar out, doesn't have to be lower, it could be wherever. And all of a sudden, they pick up a beeline that's going down to the runway, okay? So when we talk about a round out having belly, and I know all about belly, that belly is a good thing. That radius is a good thing. When your round out looks like this, you've pushed the control bar out too much, realized what you're doing, and then continued. But now we're going straight. There's no belly here. So if we're coming down 1200 a minute, that's a nice, good, steep dive and a high performance trike. Coming down 1200 feet a minute. We let out the control bar just a little bit to feel that pressure. Right here on our correct round out, that's this guy right in here. Our correct round out, what's happening to our rate of descent?
It's decreasing.
It's decreasing. So 1200 here, 1100 here, 1000 a minute here, 800, 600, 400, 200, 100, 50. That's our rate of descent. And if you notice, the jumps, and again, I'm just ballparking this, it is an exponential slowing of your descent rate. It's exponential. Now this poor guy up here decided he started to round out and then he kind of fixed the situation, but he's going straight. So he was going 1200, was going 1200. Now he's going this way, he's going 600. All right, he's not going down as fast as this guy here. And that's bad. Why is 600 a minute bad? It's bad, A, because he's slowing down, but let's not even talk about that. He's still coming down 600 here. What do you think the rate of descent is over here?
600.
600. How about here?
600.
600. Now, this poor guy, can you just think about this for a second? 12 inches. No, it's not the scale. This is our flare. Right here, we're gonna get into our flare. We're gonna talk more about the flare and benefits of a flare and what that's all about. But he's got a flare. What we don't wanna do is hit the ground, put a hole in the runway. So we're coming down 600 a minute. Now, if I'm in the back seat as an instructor, and this guy's doing 600 a minute, 3 feet in there, we're coming down 600 a minute. I'm scared. I'm wanting to get on the controls, but I've got to wait too, because if I try to round this out real soft, we might run out of airspeed altogether. We don't have enough airspeed. Point is, when you're coming down straight, your rate of descent, it may not be very high at 10 feet, and it may not be that intimidating at 8 feet, but by the time you get down to 5 feet, that ground's coming real quick. By the time you get down to 3 feet, it's quick. And a half a second late, you're in the ground. A half a second early, you've rounded out at 2 feet at 24 inches. So being a second off now, you can't control where you're gonna wind up. And you gotta do everything real quick at the last second. So if you've followed kind of the whole idea behind this landing technique, we don't want anything to happen real quick at the last second. We just don't want it. And so the guy that's coming in exponentially, he's getting lowered down very nice and slower and slower and slower and slower. And in fact, if he forgets to start flying the plane in the flare here, he will continue into the ground with no flare, but it's gonna be very soft, because by the time we get here, we're doing 50 foot a minute, you know, 25 foot a minute. Very, very slow descent because of the belly that's in that round out. So that is the importance of your round out being round. Yes?
If you were coming in on that straight 600 feet per minute descent, what would your bar position be in?
Okay, so that's a very good question. When you pull out at 80 miles an hour and you go to that flat line, you're gonna have to let the control bar out slowly. And so you're gonna be at 75, 70, 65, depends how high, 60. In order to make a straight line, you're either stabilized, you're either accelerating, or you're decelerating. In this case, we're at 80 miles an hour. You take that steep dive out at 80, the aircraft is going to decelerate. Simple physics. And all right, so last but not least, we get down, come out of our round out, we come into our flare. Couple things that need to happen. The first thing is, if we're gonna flare this with the bar all the way out to the front strut, and that's gonna happen right towards the end of the landing, I mean, a textbook landing, the control bar is gonna meet your front strut at exactly the same time that your nose wheel touches down. If the control bar makes it all the way out to the front strut, but all three wheels are still airborne, you may get a tip stall depending on how your trike is set up, and that can be very unpleasant in a hard landing and a lot of times off to one side of the runway, something like that. If you wind up with all three wheels on the ground, but you have not made the control bar all the way out to the front strut, you can expect the aircraft has energy to fly. As soon as you unload the wing, it's gonna wanna take back off into the air, and most times it will. Now, a lot of pilots have gotten around this with a modification of the technique, which is to, okay, well, the wheels touch, let me go ahead and pull the control bar in. And there is a time and a place for that. If you need to get the aircraft stopped immediately, touching down hot and applying the brakes, it works. But we want a larger margin of safety. And so one of the problems with the touch and pull method is, compared to ours, is we're gonna fly, all wheels are on the ground, we're gonna continue to fly the wing, and I'll get more on that. But the touch and pull, you can touch, bounce, and pull. And remember what I said earlier about pulling in while the aircraft's coming down and how much harder the aircraft impacts the ground when it hits and you're pulling in? and that can break the nose gear on many trikes, all trikes really, I shouldn't say many, depending on how hard you hit. And again, you've got the weight of the wing up top. A lot of these wings are already weighing in excess of 100 pounds, but they also have twist. So when that bar is in, they can actually create downforce at the wingtip. So that 100-pound wing can actually be making 200 or 300 pounds of top-heavy mass driving everything into the ground. And it's bad enough we're on three wheels. When you add 200, 300 pounds of weight up on top of an 8-foot pylon, bad things can happen. So we don't want that. The other thing is that you touch down, and let's say we're landing in a field, and there's a some kind of an animal hole, or you get a flat tire, or there's a rock, any of these things that you're going to hit. If the bar is out and the wing is making lift and you hit something on the ground, you have some instability happening in the carriage, that wing will carry the carriage past that situation and most likely keep you up. And the best example I've been given, one of my friends, John Glenn, told me this, and I never forgot it because it is the perfect analogy. And that is, if you've got a little kid and you got to run him across the street, right? Busy street, and you know, we're talking a little 4-year-old kid. What do you do with the kid? You got to run him across the street. You grab the kid's hand, he's like, whoop! And then you run him across the street, and he's just running. And it doesn't matter if he trips up, because you're going to just keep him upright, and his little feet are just going everywhere. And you get him across the street. The kid can't fall down in the middle of the street while you're trying to cross the street. That's what we're doing with the wing. The wing is going to take the carriage, and it's going to protect the carriage from tipping over or anything tripping up the wheels, because the wing is still making lift. With a Revo, when we touch down, let's say our aircraft weighs 1,000 pounds. At the point of touchdown, we just stopped making 1,000 pounds. We're making, let's just say 900 pounds at this point. That's still 900 pounds of lift up there. Just because the aircraft's on the ground doesn't mean that that wing isn't making that same 900 pounds of lift. So if you can imagine how hard it would be for a force to try to take that aircraft over on its side with 900 pounds of lift, lifting from that top point to the top of the mast, it's almost impossible. Flat tire, any of those scenarios. So the only way that you can land with the control bar out and the aircraft not take off again is you've got to bleed all the energy out of the wing. And how do we do that? It's real simple. We get down to 6 to 12 inches at the beginning of our flare. We hold 6 to 12 inches, and we hold 6 to 12 inches. And so a lot of people are going, okay, yeah, but at what point do you touch? You don't touch. I touched on this earlier. You're attempting to fly the plane this way, and the plane says, no, I don't want to fly anymore, and the plane auto-lands itself. You're literally not the one landing the aircraft. You're the one telling it to fly. The aircraft says, I don't want to do it, and the aircraft squats on the ground, and that's your landing. When that happens, if you go to full throttle, we're talking about 5 seconds in many cases. We're talking 100 horsepower Revo takes about 5 seconds. From the point that it touches down with the nose wheel on the ground, you go to full throttle, it's gonna not take off for about 5 seconds and give you an idea of just how planted the aircraft actually is. Because as we're doing this, if we take a look at the angle of attack of the wing, so we know our relative wind is this direction, right? It's exactly parallel to our flare. So if we look at what our wing now looks like, when we start this, we're going to be at relatively a somewhat low angle of attack. Again, I'm probably not, that could have been lower. And then as the aircraft slows down, we have to increase the angle of attack higher. What happens if we just keep that same angle of attack, but we lose 10 miles an hour?
It's coming down.
We're going to lose lift, all right? So if we don't push the control bar out fast enough, the aircraft's going to land. Does it still have energy to fly? You betcha. I'm gonna push the bar up some more. Get even higher, and I'm exaggerating here. Get even higher. And then finally, at that point, the aircraft's had enough. and it's not going to fly anymore, and it's not going to take off again either, because here's why. As you're increasing the angle of attack, we're also increasing the induced drag of the wing. And one thing, if you've done a bunch of landings already, if you're already a pilot or you're just training, but the one thing you probably realize, especially if you're doing full flares, which is what our technique is supporting, is that the further the bar comes out, the further that bar makes it out. So you start that flare, and hopefully the bar's back here, in this range right here when you start the flare. If the bar's out this far, something beforehand isn't quite as clean and executed perfectly as it needs to. But anyway, in a perfect world, bar's back here when we start the flare. It's behind neutral. Neutral's okay, behind neutral's okay. If you're in front of neutral by the time you start the flare, you need more work on your landings. Anyway, as we start to push out, we're moving the bar pretty slow. And as we start to go forward, and you notice, by the way, I'm leaning forward. Mm-hmm. Very important that you're not sitting back here. You lock your elbows with the bar out of reach, expect no control. If you're here, expect good control. Because in a real world, the bar's not going to just make it forward. It's going to go this way, then this way, this way, this way, and this way, and this way. But in dead still air, the bar is going to move forward, and it's going to go faster and faster and faster and faster and faster. Why is that? How come it's not linear? Well, what's happening, and you can really see it here in my exaggerated example, is as the angle of attack increases, the induced drag, I mean, this thing is an air brake. You got 12 square meters of air brake that you're pulling on. As you expose that wing to the relative wind at a high angle of attack, the deceleration of your flare is quicker and quicker and quicker. You're slowing down more from here to here than you are from here to here. And so as that airspeed drops rapidly, you have to increase the angle of attack more rapidly. So the last part of your flare is going to be pushing out quicker. And the beginning of your flare, you're going to be pushing out slower. If you push out too quick, the aircraft's going to balloon. Push out too slow, the aircraft's going to land. Now, a lot of times when you're learning, aircraft will come down. It'll take flight again. What do you do right here? Forget that it ever touched. Just because the wheels came down doesn't mean your landing's over. That's for sure. So if the wheels should skip, and next thing you know, you're back in the air, forget it ever happened. You're going to keep flying the wing until that control bar is pinned to the front strut and the wheels are down on the ground. And for some crazy reason, you get a strong enough gust, which is very rare, that when that bar's pinned, that it's coming back off the ground, but not impossible. That thing takes off again from a gust. You're going to re-energize, and you're going to do exactly the same thing again. You're going to hold it back off again. And I've flown in some pretty trashy air. I've been lifted back off the ground again once. I've never been lifted off the ground twice. So after it flies that second time, you do exactly the same thing again. The odds of it coming off the ground again are very, very, very low. Now again, if you're on a paved runway, you're in very, very gusty conditions after you touch down. And guess what? When you're using this technique, the nose wheel should come down very, very slowly. Because it's coming down slowly, it's not going to happen quick. You can relax the controls. Nothing's happening quick, and there's none of that. We're pushing the bar all the way out. The nose is coming down, and then you can relax. Now, don't pull the controls back. Don't even pull them back to neutral. Bring the control bar back 6 inches. That plane's not going anywhere. I don't care what kind of gust you get. You take out 6 inches of angle of attack, it's not coming back off the ground again. And at the same time, you're not loading the top of the aircraft down. We don't need to load the top of the aircraft down. The other benefit to having the control bar forward now, besides being able to take debris and all that, is let's just say we have to swerve, we have to turn at high speed. If the control bar is all the way out and we drop a wing, which is done mostly by pushing the wing high, okay, which is not how we do it in the air when we're flying on the backside of neutral. But as soon as we're on the front side of neutral and we're pushing, take all those backside of neutral techniques, throw them out the window, no longer apply. And now it's very important that we don't look like this and that we look like this, and I'm gonna drive this wing up. I can help a little bit, mostly to drive up in the direction of my forearm. If I'm here, this doesn't work. This works. And if the bar's out and I drive that wing high, it's gonna bring the aircraft, it's gonna turn the aircraft, and I can turn the aircraft very, very high speeds. In a Revo, we're touching down at 50, 60 miles an hour. At 60 miles an hour, I can shoot sideways across the runway and back to the center line fairly quickly. No chance of tipping over because the wing is driving me. Use the nose wheel and you've got a high CG problem. So we can steer the aircraft. And then when you want to use your nose wheel, you're going to relax the controls. That's going to give you control to your nose wheel and your brake. We don't use the nose wheel or the brake when the bar is out. So get that control bar back. Put some load onto your tires before you use your tires. What speed should you be at for that? It's a much slower speed. I'd say, you know, at least half of your touchdown speed. You want to get rid of flying the wing, decelerating with the wing flying, and then, you know, on a Revo at 25 miles an hour, you could let the control bar in and then start using, you know, your wheels after that.
That transition gradient you're talking about, is that generally the same altitude, 75 feet roughly?
Yeah, so by definition, it is gonna be right about 75 feet. Other factors would be if there's a tree line next to the runway.
Creating rotor or something like that?
Creating rotor. So talk about trees for a second. You've got a runway here. I'm just gonna draw in 3D here. Here's our runway. And then we've got trees next to the runway. And these trees are 60 feet tall. We've got the air. Our runway's downwind, so we got a crosswind. So that wind is going this way. When it comes over the trees, it's gonna go this way. And then it's actually going to continue to tumble across the runway. But what we're mostly concerned with the trike is this downwash past the trees. So obstacles, which is part of what causes transition gradient. So depending on what the obstacle is next to the runway, that's going to have a lot to do with what you're feeling in terms of loss of lift as you're getting down near the ground. So you can have loss of lift. You're landing next to corn stalks that are this high. We had an accident several years ago. A triker was landing, heavy crosswind, everything was fine, got down to 6 feet, slammed into the ground because of that downwash coming just off the little corn crops. So, you know, 60-foot tree line, expect that when you cross the tops of those trees, it's gonna feel like somebody clipped your wings off and the aircraft's gonna start to fall. And the correct method there, the steeper you are, the higher energy you are, the less effect that's going to have on you. And then you still may, depending on the intensity of the wind and the rotor and everything else, you may need to add throttle to be able to control your descent. Now, when you're coming in for a landing and you feel the aircraft sink, if you add throttle, but you hold the throttle for too long, and this is getting real into advanced stuff. You hold the throttle too long and the nose pitches up out of your steep approach as a result of you holding the throttle for too long, you just shock yourself in the foot. And I don't care if the control bar's back to your ribs, the nose is up, it's pitched out of your dive, and now getting from here down to the runway doesn't work. That's some new technique that we're not even talking about. But I promise you this, if you're using our technique that has the nice big round out, the nice low G round out, it's gonna exponentially slow your descent down to the flare so that you can pick up your flare and start flying at that point. And if you don't have that belly in your round out, all kinds of things are gonna happen very, very quickly at the bottom of the landing. And that's all we're trying to avoid. And so the faster airspeed we have up top, the steeper your approach is up top, again, a sustainable steep approach, then the slower everything's gonna happen at the bottom. Very, very counterintuitive. If you're looking down, something we didn't mention, if you're looking down at the runway while you're diving, you will tend to get ground fright and you're gonna possibly pull up too early or in some cases just have no handle on what your altitude is and go right for the ground, the instructor will have to push out and save you from impacting the ground because you didn't realize you were going to hit because you're not looking out, and looking out towards the end of the runway is how you're going to be able to judge your height and your descent rate as well. Well, thank you for joining. Sorry this is unscripted, but we did just want to share what we're doing here at the Revo Flight School, helping explain the technique that we use. And again, this is not the only technique that we use, but this is our primary go-to technique for teaching the students. And this has really worked very, very well in so many different conditions. So if you have any questions, please let us know. Thanks for watching.